say, no, hi, on their grass, but you can still mow them. Sometimes they just don't, or sometimes they, but you know, it's been quite hard to establish a different regime. And I was just wondering, will it depend on each species as to what regime, and is it more complex than just saying mow high if it's a native grass? Because we've got some areas of one type and some areas of another. And I know it really probably should be done in a more complex way, or will I get away with just saying mow high as those mowers?
Anyone got experience with the protocols? If you want to use that thing, I think you just have to make it go green. Yes.
This might not directly relate to what your situation is, but behind my house, which is in a ripe-run area, always mown the paddock very close to the ground regularly behind my house, and that gave rise to many grasses. Reason being, the exotics used to be a dairy farm, and dry grasses and so forth, and improved pastures were kept down very, very low. It didn't produce that organic material that actually feeds the soil, like fire does, it gave. There's nothing there to impede the native grasses up they came. But that doesn't work in every situation, but that's what happened in mine. So sometimes close mowing can be beneficial.
How frequent?
Oh, well, yeah, every like a few weeks. So just keep it down short all the time. So not just a once a year cut.
Yeah, I can add to that. John and I have worked together for a long time, and John's crazy ideas are crazy, I might say, but they sort of work. It's actually quite funny. I think a lot of us are actually trying to get you on the right track, yeah? But that mower that he had, the sculptured mower, is actually a very good tool. You can't buy it off shelf, but you know, I mean, someone to build it for, do something for you, or encourage council maybe to change their mower time. So you then do get the different heights that you're talking about. And again, I'm also a fan, one of the reasons I mentioned the height and the mowing and looking after it in my talk really was about a council that is down south, and they had quite a lot of grass, native grasses on a particular site, but the operator refused to cut them. Now, they died out. Grasses do need some sort of mowing, some sort of disturbance, and that's why I like sheep. Sheep are great. I was going to say to John, we should throw some sheep in his vineyard, you know, because I think the way they eat the grass actually is beneficial to the grass. So our artificial stuff is very artificial. So if you're going to go artificial, John's mower concept is actually good. If you can't every couple of years throw some sheep in there.
I just want to say something too. I agree with everything that's been said. I think that the biomass removal is really an important thing. I wouldn't be mowing high, I'd just be mowing low, not necessarily every year, just to get rid of that biomass. I'd be trying to remove it as well as possible. But one other thing I really want to say is having a look at the Western Ring Road around Melbourne, and the Hume Highway going up from Melbourne to Sydney, the weed spread by slashing is just incredible. So one really important thing, I try and make sure whoever slashes your roadside actually cleans their slashing equipment and tractor before.
We actually have
an eelgrass
which we're managing really well by a really rigorous thing.
Yeah, that spread really well by mowers. So yeah, just make sure they don't go over that and keep on going. So.
Who's our SA waterman?
Thanks. Question for you, Bruce. I was really fascinated by that old painting, the Murnoch Hill. I'm really with the way grass is shifting their genetics through time, and the Yandazes that I'm familiar with in woodlands around the place here are quite a small clone, and from what I've read of those Yandfields, they seem to be, to my impression, quite a different beast with quite a big tumour, and do you think there's something in that, like the, maybe the soil type or maybe the actual selection of those, and have you still got those types of yam daisies in places?
We're still learning all about those yams. Lake Silata is the one that produces the best tumour, but my son is growing Scapigera, and it is producing a tuber that looks more like Langsdale. And so we don't know why. We're trying to find that out. Langsdale produces a tuber about that size, and it looks insignificant, but it's 7 times as nutritious as a potato. And the sugar is actually fructans, not fructose. It's very gentle for diabetics. This is a vegetable that's going to be very useful, but whatever you're doing with your yam is good science, because everything we find out adds to the science. When I first started looking at it, people whose names turned up when you started Googling things like that were Beth Gott and Isaac Beatty, and very little else. And the same with the grasses. When I was looking at the grasses, Ian's name turned up all the time. There hadn't been a lot of, you know, this is going back a little bit in time, hadn't been a lot done on them. So everything you learn about it is really good science. One bloke told me that he harvested his Murnong, forgotten about them, left them in a flower pot in a north-facing window, and they shriveled. He planted them and got a 70% reproduction rate from those dried things. So they're a tough little number. And that was good science. It was an accident, but it was good science. So we're learning from everything we do.
Okay, this is a question I guess across the entire panel, but given that all the projects we're hearing are either government-inspired, local government-inspired, or agency-inspired, and really need to be, the audience here is largely local government, or an alternative seeking to try to restore environments to private European colonisation, where's the commercial imperative in this? Because we know that the large areas, not those under government, but those that they are under commercial. So if we're going to try to do a restoration on a big scale, we've got to make this commercial.
Nasty question.
I think this is just a guess, but I think that if, say, in 5 or 7 years' time, 2 or 3% of the Australian grain field was under native grasses, and this is grain that people are going to mill and turn into flour. Say we had 3% like that, then that means that some grain fields have never been ploughed, and so, you know, all you scientists, you start taking notes and drill me later, but is there going to be some kind of carbon sequestration going on because we're not ploughing, we're not using a diesel-driven vehicle to plough it with? There's carbon credits in this, I think. And sure, the yield from the from something like kangaroo grass is nowhere near that of wheat, but you're getting two crops. You're getting a crop for animals, and you're getting a grain. Plus the fact that somewhere down the track, a Prime Minister is going to reward people for looking after the environment. Hopefully be sooner. I can see people smiling. You don't believe me, hey? It's hard to believe. But trust in God. he's stated that he's environmentalist, so it's obviously going to happen soon. You know, these are the little things that we can do, and I believe that they'll have an impact. If you started altering 3% of the Australian grain fields, the next year it'd be 6%, the next year it'd be 9%. Look what happened to solar power. Against every bit of government incentive, the Australians defied the government and put up solar panels because they could see the common sense now. The people had their say, and we've got a massive amount of power now, to the point where people blame the weather, blame solar and wind power for a natural event. We must be winning.
Sometimes the answer is not any obvious. that crazy machine of mine at the end of my presentation, the concept there was to, hey, if I get out of here and convert wheat stubble into charcoal, right, carbon sequestration, beauty. So the government funds could pour it in the ground and we'd be making progress. But by accident, and accident of whatever, people have a miss sometimes and they haven't, right? I discovered that, chloris with the particular inoculation doubled the production of grapes in the vineyard. Now that would probably ruin the industry. Good vineyard owners don't want to double their crop. But in the Barossa, dieback is a real problem. And you can get actually the bigger in the vines and actually minimise your fruit production by keeping the water down, saving water. There might be a good use for chloris. I know Chris Benpole tastes my chloris right next to his little block, but he's been frustrated by it, but let's face it, chloris has been almost taking over the grass, and it's not my fault, it's just pretty, and that's what's happening. Maybe we can make use of it in a roundabout sort of a way.
I've got to have something to say now. Commercial imperative, Ian. I might say that in about 92, I think it was, we got together talking about native grasses, and there were probably four people I could muster to even think about talking about it. Look at it today. But all of you great people here, thank you all for coming along, I might add. So I think the imperative comes from within your own need to start off, and also the projects that all of you will think about. After this conference, you'll all go, I've got an idea, I really want to push this. Now, you might do that at local government, you might do that at state agency, or you might lobby federal minister somewhere along the line, or you might do what we do, and that is try and do it on a commercial basis, and that's with clients and larger people, and throw ideas at them. And people are after innovation. I hate to be in a turmoil, but innovation definitely, and the native grass concept and all of the attributes that we might be able to get from native grasses are there for us to move to the next commercial bit. But I've got to say, you know, in 92, there was bugger all around. Then I met Bob over there, and Bob Myers it is, and really it all started to happen for us in South Australia. So the imperative is here, I think. It's for us to really go, where's the project? Where's the next big thing? Thank you.
I absolutely agree with you, Ian. Being in exactly the same position as a seed grower and seller, we can't rely on council budgets, or we can't rely on handouts from the government as in the form of grants. That's what we're kind of living on at the moment. I mean, there's things like the mining companies are doing re-veg, which there needs to be legislation, I think, like in North America, that actually kickstarts this industry. And the industry at the moment, although there's lots of excited people here, I see them whenever I go to these kind of forums. We all go home and we're excited, and then you know, everyone's forgotten about it a couple of weeks later. And Wayne is probably right, it is slightly gaining ground. But as a seed grower, we're not making a lot of money out of selling seed, and the market just is not there at the moment. I do believe that in the future there will be a market, a good market for native grass seed, and hopefully Ian and myself and a small handful of others will be in the minority. But I think you can't just rely on things the way they are. It needs to change, and it needs to be a commercial thing. And I don't know, other than legislation saying that Vic Roads or the roads authorities need to use a certain percentage of native grass seed in a mix would kickstart this industry, because none of us would be able to supply just even that small amount. So, Ian, we just hang on and keep our fingers crossed and see what happens.
As an outsider in the sort of commercial side of it, I'd be fascinated to know which species you think are most likely to be commercialisable, either as stock feed or as grain for human consumption. I mean, we all have to have our quinoa, et
etc. I mean, the community has this insatiable demand for sustainable food. I wonder if there are some species that you've identified that are closer to potential commercialisation than others.
I'd just like to say something too. Again, I think Bruce is actually right too. I think that there's a huge, I mean, we talk about quinoa as the ancient grain, not nearly as ancient as panicking.